All right. We are here.
We're back.
Hello, everyone. We're back.
With another episode. Another episode about it.
It's been a while, but we're back. We
like,
have
what,
some
2 weeks?
2 weeks. Not a while, but it's been, it's been some time.
So two things. We have somewhat of a live studio audience.
We got
today.
Some friends in the studio today just watching.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're excited to watch watch a real episode in real time. So if you hear some voices in the background, that's them. And then also, it is with great sadness that we do have to announce that Heard About It as a regular podcast will be coming to an end.
This is one of three episodes remaining.
Yes.
We will probably be back next summer.
Yes. We may periodically do things in
maybe
the
a Christmas
winter,
special.
Christmas, some holidays in the summer, but this will be the last three regularly done episodes. Sorry, someone is now leaving. I guess we're too boring for one of our friends who just left the studio.
He had a phone call to answer,
so he had to quietly step out. But as always, we do have Kieran in the studio with us.
I'm back. What's up, y'all?
No camera on him.
No camera today, but we get to hear him. How are you doing, Kieran?
For time's sake.
I'm doing good. It's a little sad. It's coming to an end. Smile because it happened, you know?
Yeah.
You were here for half of it. Did you enjoy your half of Heard About It?
Yeah, your season?
Of course.
I think your season was better. I mean, no offense, Jason.
No offense to Jason.
But I think this season has been better than season one.
We didn't try to take advantage of those shorts anymore. We were kind of done with those.
Yeah.
We were just pure...
Pure podcast.
Pure podcast.
And we're about to give you...
Our own opinions.
Pure podcast right now.
Oh, also, I'm on a different mic. We are rushing to get this episode in.
Yeah, we had to...
And my microphone is elsewhere right now.
We had to hastily put this together. But that doesn't mean the content of the episode won't be as good. And... We're going to kick things off with Marvel's announcements at San Diego Comic-Con revolving around the MCU. Now, we don't like to do a lot of current stuff anymore, but I think this is a really interesting discussion question I wanted to talk about, which is, let me pull it up here.
So I haven't even watched anything. I don't even know what was announced.
Or is Marvel and the MCU moving in the right direction after what has been considered by many and pretty unanimously a low point in the MCU, whether that's not as good films as they used to be, too much focus on the TV shows along with the films, or just general superhero fatigue, Marvel movies haven't been making money anymore and they haven't been as popular. But they seem to be going through some changes and have done some soul searching and kind of because the last film to release was the Marvels, which was last year.
What about Deadpool and Wolverine?
Which Deadpool and Wolverine just released, and that is already the biggest opening for any R-rated film ever, and I think it's already recouped its budget, so it's doing really well at the box office for them. So with that being said, they have Deadpool and Wolverine. Up next, then, they'll have the new Captain America, which looks very promising, Brave New World, which seems to be a focus back on kind of like the vibe of Winter Soldier. You then get the Brave New World should carry into Thunderbolts, and then they're going to do
Thunderbolts?
Which is kind of the Suicide Squad of Marvel, usually. So it's a lot of anti-heroes. So I think Captain America 4 will carry into Thunderbolts, and then we're going to get a Fantastic Four movie, and then two new Avengers movies. Now, the Avengers movies are the two big change-ups they have made that I think prompt this question.
Because initially it was like Secret Wars. And
it's still Secret Wars. So the original plan was the Kang Dynasty and Secret Wars.
Okay.
I think their plan is to just scrap Kang completely given Jonathan Majors is firing. They're not going to recast Kang. So now they are bringing in Doctor Doom as the lead villain and calling Avengers 5 Doomsday and Avengers 6 still Secret Wars.
Okay.
The biggest news in all of that I just mentioned, however, which is the most controversial, is the fact that Robert Downey Jr. will be playing Doctor Doom in the MCU.
Which is one of the dumbest
things. Even though he already played, which, very questionable, why would they ever do that? And I will agree. I like everything they've announced at and they've talked about at San Diego Comic-Con. I liked everything except that announcement of Robert Downey Jr. being Doctor Doom.
It's so stupid. He's such an iconic character already. Why would they recast him for another thing. And the fact that they have these things called variants already, and it's just going to confuse everybody that's already watching. Like, oh, is this Iron Man still, or is this a completely different character?
I think that's what's messing them up. And like, I will say what would have been worse was if they had said, no, it's a variant of Tony Stark. Yes. They're not doing that. So at least they're saying, well, no, he's just same actor, different character in the MCU. He's just playing. But it's still just like there was no need. And like, I guess there was some initial excitement. But when you stop to think about it, it's like this doesn't make sense. Mm-mm. There's so many actors out there, mm-hmm. big actors, iconic actors, so many you could have brought in to play Victor Von Doom. Because he is such a... I think it was very exciting for a lot of Marvel fans to hear Doctor Doom was finally coming into the yeah. MCU. I was very excited because he's one of my favorite Marvel villains, yeah. even though he's not in the MCU. I mean, he's just so iconic looking and just really cool and his whole deal.
I think it also won't help that Doctor Doom is like metal.
Also. Yeah, well, no, did you hear he said at San Diego Comic-Con, kind of like joking about that, he was like, same mask, new task, or something said like that.
Oh, you can't do that.
So, and yeah, that's what's confusing people, because there are actually in the comics variants of Tony Stark that become Doctor Doom, but they're not doing that. So mm-hmm. it's just a whole confusing situation. However, another thing I'd like to mention is the Russo brothers, who directed, I think, every Avengers movie so far, is coming back to direct the next two, which is somewhat comforting to know that they're still helming the project.
Yeah.
But other than all the Robert Downey Jr. stuff, this looks like, from San Diego Comic-Con and Deadpool and Wolverine, this looks like a Marvel I am more familiar with. And the Marvel, this looks like a re-energized Marvel that after one of the worst openings ever for a superhero film and Quantumania and Marvels and a bunch of those, they were like, okay, we need to do something. They went back. They reanalyzed their plan, especially after the Jonathan Majors getting fired and his trial. They said, how can we take what we've had so far and retool it into something better? And so there's been, I think there's a lot less announcements coming out. I think they're definitely reducing the amount of content coming out each year, which I think reduces the fatigue. It's more quality over quantity focused, it seems.
Good.
It's a lot of projects that I think people are excited about. And it seems to be like they're going in the right direction.
I think it's going to be really hard to get their fan base back if they want to at all, because the connection of the characters and stuff is all completely gone. So they're going to have to rebuild from the ground up again to actually get a solid franchise on its feet again.
But I think they have a good, what you said, you know, they're going to have to get a lot of people back. And I will say, I think Deadpool and Wolverine is part of that plan. Because I think you have so many people, and I know that's a lot of like Deadpool fans, but I'm sure that's a big overlap of yeah. Deadpool fans who are also loved the MCU, yeah. and so you're bringing in people who still love Deadpool back into the fold of the MCU, and it was an incredible like the Deadpool and Wolverine. I'm not going to spoil anything, but I will say Deadpool and Wolverine, they did such a good job of making it feel both like a sequel to the first two Deadpools. It still felt like a Deadpool movie and also felt like another entry into the Marvel Cinematic Universe. They did mm-hmm. a good job of making those, because those feels like those couldn't coexist.
Yeah.
And they did a good job of making those coexist in that film. Hmm. But no, I think they're on a really good track to kind of bring them back to a level and a quality that people remember them for.
Mm-hmm. It's just a question that if they can get the people to go back to the theaters or watch it on Disney Plus.
Yeah. I think the streaming has really hurt them.
I think they should just get rid of all TV shows.
The TVs were the worst, I will admit. The TVs yeah. were the biggest mistake, I think.
Because there was so much content to consume that people just kind of lost time for it.
And what happened
wasn't as special.
And it wasn't. It was also, I think, a lot of people. A, there were a lot of TV shows coming out that I feel like people couldn't keep up with.
Mm-hmm.
B, not everyone had Disney Plus, mm-hmm. so you lose a lot of the Marvel fans who didn't own Disney Plus. And C, they put such vital stuff to the MCU and the TV shows that for those two group of people I've just mentioned, now they feel like, well, I'm not caught up on the overall story of the MCU. why bother going to see any more of the movies? And I think that is what hurt them over time. And I think, I don't really think they have that many future TV shows planned. At least I need to go
I
back.
Hope not. But I don't think there is.
I don't think there's, I think maybe, there's like Iron, or I think they've actually, Iron Wars was going to be a TV show. They've retooled it into a movie.
Good.
So I think they're thinking better, like, let's retool these into movies.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I just think they're going in the right direction. I mean, I think the real stress test of, you know, they have some momentum with Deadpool and Wolverine. Can they deliver and keep that going with Brave New World is the important question.
Yeah. I also think that it's coming at a really interesting time, because when Marvel first started back in the late 2000s, they had no competition.
Mm-hmm.
Now DC is under the rule of James Gunn.
Yes.
And so they're going to be starting fresh, both of them, head to head in the exact same time.
Well, I don't think Marvel's necessarily starting fresh.
Well, like, I mean, in the idea, me?
They're trying to, hit kind of not full reset, but they're trying to regain their momentum and try to get back to ground zero where they started.
Yeah.
They're trying to play catch up, while James Gunn, I mean, he just showed off the trailer for the first DC Universe project.
Does it look good?
It was animated.
Oh.
So it's, and I really like James Gunn's approach.
Mm-hmm.
He wants to create where the it's a multimedia universe of canonical stuff.
Okay.
So even animated TV shows play into the live action canon. So he's doing essentially a Suicide Squad sequel about a new Amanda Waller task force called Creature Commandos. And, you know, he's working really hard on the Superman movie, and a lot of people think that's going to be very promising.
I don't think Superman is a way to go for them, but
I think Superman is actually amazing when it's done right.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I think what you also get is superhero Marvel, but I think to your point, it's not just DC, because so many people, you know, everyone wants a superhero franchise now.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of different ones out there. And, you know, it's not just Marvel.
Mm-hmm.
If you want something a little darker, you can go to The Boys. Or if you want something a little darker and a little fun, you can go to Invincible. You know, there's these other universes. There's these other superheroes coming out. And so Marvel's not the only person out here.
Yeah.
And so I think that definitely has changed.
But
for
kind
them.
Of on your point about how it's not like a full reset, I think there's an argument to be stated that it's more like, sure, it's not the entire thing resetting, but I feel like there's still some resetting happening in Marvel because they completely got rid of the Kang Dynasty.
I'm sure behind the scenes they've scrapped a whole plot line.
Yeah.
So, and here's what's interesting, and I wanted to talk about this. Secret Wars, when this was still, I don't think we can even call this the multiverse saga anymore,
because
it doesn't seem like it's going. So there's two Secret Wars stories that are very different in the comics.
Mm-hmm.
And well, here's what's funny. I think their plan for Avengers 6 was to do the most recent Secret Wars, which is about an incursion. Which, if you don't remember, Multiverse Madness, incursion is when two universes collide and either one or both gets destroyed. So they did one of those where it was the mainline universe and the ultimate universe, Marvel's two biggest universes, had an incursion. And so I think they were leading up to that. Because Doctor Doom is now the big villain, I think they're now pivoting to the 80s Secret Wars, which was very different.
Mm-hmm.
But Doctor Doom was the big villain of that series. So it's kind of funny. They didn't have to do the name change for Secret Wars, but I'll bet you they've totally retooled the plot of that last film.
Yeah, I'm sure.
But
we'll never see the light of day of that thing.
So. Yeah, I mean,
which is for the best, really.
But to be fair, this isn't uncommon. I think when MatPat, RIP, released his video on the James
Gunn. He didn't die, don't worry.
He didn't die. But when he released his video on the James Gunn's DC Universe talking about it, he was referencing how Marvel functioned back then, and he talked about how much schedules and plots got changed.
Yeah.
Early, like, you could easily tell they were ready to move stuff around.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think,
and they never really laid out, like, a 10-year timeline.
You know? No, they had pretty short. Well, I mean, they would announce, he talks about in those early days, they would just announce projects that would happen in 5 years.
Yeah.
So I'm excited, though, to see, because I think Marvel is finally at a point where I'm excited about the next four movies.
Yeah.
And there hasn't been a point like that in a while.
Did you ever watch Guardians 3?
Guardians 3 is still... I need to watch it. I do still... That's on my
watch
list.
I haven't seen Deadpool and Wolverine yet, so I don't really have that excitement yet. So maybe I'll get that after I watch it.
Yeah.
Which... Someday.
Yeah, and here's what's interesting. I was really expecting Deadpool and Wolverine to be the movie that really gave me a renewed hope in the MCU, and it wasn't exactly that, but it was funny. I think it was Deadpool and Wolverine and the combination of the San Diego Comic-Con announcements that really pushed me towards that direction.
Mm. Okay. Yeah, I mean, that makes sense. There was a lot announced there.
Yeah.
And it's interesting. Like, I think a lot of those are interesting titles. Because I thought it was going to be all terrible based on the only thing that I had heard was about Robert Downey.
Oh, yeah.
But.
Yeah, and they showed off some Fantastic Four footage, and it looks very interesting because it's kind of going for, you know, like that vibe in Disney World Tomorrowland where it's like how people thought the future was going to look in the 50s.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So Fantastic Four totally has that like Tomorrowland vibe to it. And so it's, I think it's a different universe. It's not the mainline universe, but the Fantastic Four are kind of from this world where it's kind of like...
And we have...
Pedro Pascal as Mr. Fantastic.
Yeah.
Who I think a lot of people are not happy about his casting. I think he could do a really good job.
One of our audience members says
Joseph Quinn, who is known as Eddie in Stranger Things, is playing Johnny Storm, which that'll I think will be really awesome. Good. One of the guys from The Bear
Johnny
is
Storm?
Ben Grimm.
I think. Are you sure? What? I thought it was Sue Storm.
Sue, there's two. They're brother. There's brother and sister.
Oh, there's siblings.
Yeah, and then Sue Storm. I forget the actress who's playing Mrs. Fantastic, but I've heard she's really good. And then, yeah, I don't.
Who's the Thing?
The Thing is one of the guys from The Bear. I forget his name. Not the main guy. It's like a bald guy with a beard.
I don't remember, all you need, really.
Yeah. So he'll be a good Ben Grimm, it seems like. And then I think Galactus is going to be the villain of the Fantastic Four movie. And they've confirmed the Fantastic Four will be in the next two Avengers. So
Galactus is a celestial, right?
Not celestial, I think. He's an interesting character. He consumes planets. So he's a giant cosmic being that consumes planets. And it's weird. Kieran, was there any development that our audience member told you?
Oh, yes. Our audience member just pulled up the actual cast of the new Fantastic Four. So Mr. Fantastic is Reed Richards. Sorry, that's Pedro Pascal.
Yeah.
I'm not very familiar with the Fantastic Four, but anyways. Okay. Invisible Woman is Vanessa Kirby.
Vanessa Kirby, that's her name. That's right.
The Human Torch is Joseph Quinn.
Joseph Quinn.
The Thing is Ebon Moss Bachrock?
I think that's his name, yeah.
Sounds European.
But he's in The Bear.
So, yeah.
Yeah, thank you, audience member.
Did you know, Kieran, that Fantastic Four was one of the first, like, I guess it was 20th century at the time, but it was like one of the first like Marvel IP, in quotes, thing to come out.
Well, it was the first Stan Lee thing. So it was really, really funny story I'm actually going to tell about the Fantastic Four right now.
Here we go.
Stan Lee was writing for what would become the Marvel Comics Company. It was like it was originally a division of like a larger publishing company. Mm-hmm. And I think Captain America and Namor and like Nick Fury and the Howling Commandos, all of those were kind of characters that he started writing for. He didn't create them, but he was getting really sick of writing comics, and so he was gonna go in to quit, and he went into his boss's office, and his boss said, "Oh great, Stan, you're here, I needed to talk to you," and he shows him Justice League issue number one. And he goes, "I need you to make a team-up team. I want a Captain America, Namor, and Human Torch was actually a different character than the Fantastic Four character at that time in Marvel. So he says, "I want you to write a team-up." Stan Lee decided, because he was going to quit anyway, just write what he wanted to write, which is why he wanted to quit in the first place. He didn't feel like he was writing what he wanted to write.
Yeah.
So he then creates the Fantastic Four as a competition to the Justice League, and it's kind of Stan Lee's first original creation that really became really big.
Hmm.
So
interesting.
Yeah.
So Human Torch was the only one that they knew, like in the Fantastic
and
Four.
And he was this weird thing where he was like some android that could catch on fire. And so he changed him into Johnny Storm. So similar powers. But so yeah, Fantastic Four are the first kind of. Captain America is kind of the first, then Namor. And then you get the Fantastic Four, which is the first Stan Lee characters. So yeah, they're kind of the OG Stanley Marvel characters. So it's kind of incredible that it's taken this long. And I know there's been a lot of rights and moving around and buying back and stuff, but it's taken a long time for them to come to the MCU. So it's very exciting to see those characters show up. Because I do really like, I think it's a cool, they're cool characters.
They are, yeah.
So yeah, that's it for Marvel. I think they're going to move in the right direction, hopefully. But I jury's still out, but just from a outsider's view, looking at what they've been saying and what we've seen, other than a few questionable casting choices with the big villain, I think they can move in the right direction. And I can look over Robert Downey Jr. being Dr. Doom. Because he will. Like, here's what sucks. He'll do a good job.
He will.
He'll do a good job. It'll be frustrating to watch.
Yeah, don't you worry a little bit of that, like, Iron Man persona is going to bleed in?
No, I don't think so.
He's a really good actor. I think what people forget is that Robert Downey Jr. is a very good actor. And Dr. Doom and Tony Stark are very different characters.
To be fair, after his villain arc starts, he's going to have a mask on the entire time. So we won't... There'll be a point where you'll forget that it's Robert Downey Jr. Dr. Doom,
his whole thing is he's disfigured. So I'm assuming all we're getting at that point is a voice.
Yeah.
At a certain point. Which it's not like we're seeing Tony Stark's face the whole time.
And it's not like he'll have a goatee, so...
Yeah.
You know? Which is like the iconic, like, yeah, Iron Man... So, yeah.
So anyway, that's what Marvel's kind of laid out in front of us. We'll see if they could deliver and kind of bring us back to good old fashioned Marvel superhero fun.
We'll see.
Anyway,
I'm skeptical.
Changing topics entirely, to quote John Mulaney. No, weren't expecting that good of a segue, were you?
Oh, that was the best one yet, Walker.
We're gonna do a quick review of not just one game, but not just two games,
three,
but three games. We've talked about them a lot.
About superheroes. This one, yeah, not so super, but
definitely a hero.
Yeah.
The Arkham trilogy, the Batman Arkham trilogy, which one of my favorite game series of all time.
We did review Arkham City.
We have reviewed Arkham City.
I remember talking about like Hugo Strange and stuff on here. I feel like we did. Did we?
You know what? We'll just play it safe and review Arkham Asylum.
Can we do that though? Is that too close?
No, it's not too close. We want to review Arkham Asylum.
Okay, that's fair.
If we were trying to figure out, we talk about these series so much, we couldn't remember if we had ever actually officially reviewed one of those three games. And it sounds like we did do Arkham City.
Yeah, I think we did.
Okay, so we'll do Arkham Asylum, which is another really great game. I don't want to do Knight, because Knight is too similar to City, and Asylum is very different.
Asylum is very different.
And we'll talk about why it's very different. So Arkham Asylum, if y'all don't know, is the first game in the Arkham trilogy. You play as Batman, surprisingly.
Wow.
Actually, just
Batman throughout this entire one. In City, we talked about earlier, you start as Bruce Wayne.
Oh, yeah, it's really cool. And Asylum changes it up a lot. And then City had a dual campaign, so you could play as Batman and Catwoman.
Yeah.
But I'm not a huge fan of the Catwoman missions.
I want to stay... like, it's like in Spider-Man when you have those MJ missions or Miles missions. It's like, let me be
Batman.
Spider-Man.
Yeah, let me be Batman. But back to Asylum. So the game's basic premise is Joker is able to take control of the Asylum and releases all the inmates, and Batman has to figure out what Joker's planning and stop him. Really cool game. It is definitely one thing that I think Asylum beats City and Night in is its atmosphere.
Yeah.
Asylum's atmosphere is some of the best atmosphere in a game because...
it's something you can digest. Whereas in City... you have a whole city to go around, obviously. Yeah. And then in Asylum, you're stuck on an island where Arkham Asylum is. And it's a lot smaller.
There's definitely a theme. Whereas opposed to City, when you do open world games like City or Night, you're not going to get... atmosphere is harder to get. Well, there's still atmosphere in both games. I think Night has a little bit less of it. City has a cooler atmosphere because it's this run down, like worse than Gotham. It's snowing the whole time. Mm-hmm.
Night is in Gotham.
Night is all of Gotham, so you kind of lose that atmosphere.
Yeah.
But Asylum just has such this great atmosphere because you're in this asylum, and it's this like weird island, and there's all these different buildings and it's very gothic, you know, it's almost a horror. Like, it comes very close to being a horror
game.
One thing Asylum, I think, doesn't have over the other games is its villains. It has a weird choice of villains.
What does it have? Joker, Scarecrow.
So, Joker, Scarecrow, Bane, Harley Quinn. Killer Croc and Riddler.
Riddler.
Which is a decent... Oh, and Poison Ivy. Thank you for our great audience member here reminding us. Yeah, so those seven, which I think... And it's not that that's a bad list, but you see a lot of villains that you don't then get to fight in Asylum, which is kind of cool. Like, you see Mr. Freeze's prison at one point, and then like you get to talk to Clayface.
Which it makes sense.
It makes sense, because, but, you know,
that's where they're all kept.
That's where they're all kept. And I think that's what's exciting about a game inside the Asylum, is that it's where all the Batman's villains are. But yeah, there's this eeriness to it, you know, because it's abandoned. There's everyone running around. It's run down. You know, you'll be in a facility and they'll just be repeating the same like video over and over again. The music is really well done.
The music is very well done. You have some of the best performances of Mark Hamill and Kevin Conroy.
Yeah, getting them back to voice those characters were a no-brainer. And one of my favorite parts about that game is you'll be around the facility, and the like Joker will come on the intercom, like talking to his men to take care of Batman. And it's very different. So it's more of a Metroidvania, actually. A lot of people describe it more like that than an open world game, because you essentially, there's different areas in the game, and then you can't access those areas, so you get certain items. And so it plays a lot more like a Metroidvania, where it's like, okay, you got to go to this building. I can't get to that building, so now I got to go here. But yeah, I really like it. And the Scarecrow, and like my favorite part is probably the Scarecrow missions.
Really? That's really interesting, because I distinctly remember you saying, the Scarecrow missions are fine.
Really? I think gameplay-wise, they're not the best, but I just love... Just, it's so cool the way they... If you play the game, like, it's mostly of like... No. Hear me out. A lot of people are like giving me like weird looks in the studio right now. When you actually get to when you fight Scarecrow and you got to sneak around his giant body, those parts are
Kieran. Iffy. That sentence for Kieran is one of the craziest sentences.
Yeah, those parts are iffy, because there's this. But when the toxin is just hitting you, and it's like you go into a door and you go right back to the same room that you just left, and then like there's that really cool scene where you're walking down this long hallway as Batman, and with every lightning flash, it slowly turns into the alley, and you turn into young Bruce. And it's like it recreates the scene where he loses his parents. Like, it does really cool stuff like that. And there's actually a really cool part of the game where you get the Scarecrow toxin, and they make you look like the game glitches out, and it plays the cutscene from the beginning of the game, but Batman and Joker have been swapped. And so it's those parts of the Scarecrow missions that I really like. Then when you get into the actual levels, I will admit it's
the platformer.
The platforming and the stealth. It's still fun. It's not as good as some of the other stealth parts.
Yeah.
And
I think, did Assassin's Creed come up before this? Probably.
It's that whole era of that kind of gluttony.
What was the very first one of the, like, you sneak around, take down one at a time? I can't remember what it was called.
Metal Gears. I mean,
no, it wasn't Metal Gear. It was I never played it. It's Thief? Something. No,
was it an Assassin's Creed game?
No, it wasn't Assassin's Creed. Yeah. I can't remember what it was called.
But yeah, what do you prefer? Just question. What do you prefer out of the Arkham games? Do you prefer the stealth missions or the beat 'em up missions?
Stealth. Missions. Yes, I love the, especially once you get to the later of the game. The entire premise of the game is that you kind of go through each room, and each room there's going to be thugs just kind of guarding, not letting you pass to the next one. And eventually, like, Joker traps all these gargoyles that hang from the ceiling, and that's where you kind of zip line to sneak away. And eventually he straps bombs to them. It's so, like, you have limited
access.
Yeah, if
you stay there too long, it blows up.
Of them. And, like, and if you're not careful about it, they'll see you up on the gargoyles as well and try to shoot you down. And it's just some of the best stealth
The Stealth is really good because even in all three games, the AI and the NPCs still looks really good. I don't know how complex it is. I think we've talked about this. But, I mean, it's really well done where they'll be walking around. They'll call. If they see a downed body, everyone will go up. They'll talk a little bit. They'll spread out again. And it's, like, really well done in the way you can set it up.
And when it's, like, the last two, they'll, like, team up and start staying back-to-back.
And it's really cool, though. The game does a good job. I think Asylum is probably the best one at slowly, as you get more items and stuff, the goons start getting more stuff. Mm-hmm. And so it kind of escalates into that. One thing I've always appreciated about those games is that, like, you can get shot twice and you die.
Yeah.
Like, it's not like Batman can be taking all these shots. Like, I mean... Like you have to work. I mean, it's like
Spider-Man, you have like so many chances to get shot and you can
because Spider-Man can dodge the bullets, which is understandable because he's Spider-Man, which is more. And that's one thing though I appreciate about the Spider-Man games over the Arkham games, even though I like the Arkham games better. In Spider-Man, even when he's fighting people just like hand to hand and not stealthing, they're still using guns.
Yeah.
You know, because of how the Arkham mechanics work, for some reason, most of the time, none of the goons when Batman is just fighting them hand to hand ever have a gun with them. Sometimes they do, but rarely. Yeah. Just so that way Batman doesn't have to worry about getting shot all the time.
To be fair though, in Spider-Man you can reheal like instantly.
Oh yeah,
Batman, you have to wait until you defeat all of them and then the bats swarm around you and you get health back.
I also like the UI of the Arkham games. I like the art style more of like the pause menu, and it has one of my favorite things, which is the ghost of Arkham, which is this really cool thing where you can find these weird like encryptions kind of in the walls, and they tell the story of the founder of Arkham. And then also you can find the like interview tapes with all the inmates, so you can hear like all these psychiatrists talking to all the villains. It's really cool because Harley's isn't her getting interviewed, it's her when she was a psychiatrist interviewing Joker.
The Joker eventually,
because that's her origin story, is Joker drives her crazy.
And so you get to hear all these stories about these characters you'll meet in the later games, but you understand like where they're from from this game.
Yeah. One character I forgot to mention, who I didn't learn about in the Batman universe until I played these games, was Victor Zsasz, who's a very disturbing character.
Yeah, I remember him.
He's the serial killer who tally marks all his deaths on his skin.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Arkham, I definitely think. Asylum, though I think they definitely improved on the formula, I still love it because it's so different from the other two that I still think it's willing. Talking about it right now, I want to go back and play it. It's so atmospheric. Really all good. The locations are really cool. Like, I just, like I get a feeling of, like, ooh, like, what's going to happen next playing Arkham Asylum more than I ever play. As much as I love Knight the best and City, like, Arkham is probably my least favorite. But
it's still so good.
It's still so good, and I think still so fun to go back to time and time again. Do you remember the scene that always gets me from that game is there's a mission where you have to save Gordon from Harley, and if you get found out you're in there, instead of just giving you the game over sequence, it plays a whole cutscene of Harley Quinn just like shooting Gordon at point blank range with a machine gun.
Yeah.
And you just watch it every time and you're like just like, gosh.
Yeah. I love the death screens.
Oh yeah. I mean, iconic death screens.
Was it a motion capture thing or did they animate it? Do you know?
I think they just animated it.
Okay, so basically it's like any villain that is the boss of the goons
of that section
will like, it's like a black background and it's as if like you're on the floor and the camera's looking up at them and they just come up to you and they just have like this one off like small little monologue of just like saying,
and it's as if like Batman is like on the ground looking up, and so they're like leaning, and then they're leaning down,
kick him,
looking at Batman and talking to him. So really great game. We're going to give it a thumbs up.
Thumbs up.
Thumbs up.
Karen, do you give it a
thumbs up? I give it a thumbs up. Actually, I give it two thumbs up.
Audience member, do you give it a thumbs up?
Yeah. That's five thumbs up. Look at that. No, that's four. That's four. That's five. One, two, three. I can count. Yeah. Well, we wanted to keep this episode short today, guys. So
we didn't have a lot of time, so no game. We'll be back next week with more stuff to talk about and probably a game and
Yeah,
yeah, we'll and then be for here. Our final episode, we're gonna have a fun event to do.
We'll plan something fun for the last episode. So, enjoy y'all's week. Glad y'all tuned in for this long, and we'll see you in the next episode.
See you.
Goodbye.